Thank you very much. Thank you very much for the introduction, and thank you very much for welcoming me in such a nice, graceful manner this year here. It was really a joy and very, very productive for me to work with Professor Necipoğlu so closely and have conversations with her. It really, you know, vastly improved my my work, my research. I should also like to thank Professor Kafadar, with whom also I have these wonderful sohbets as well. And Cecily Pollard is wonderful. You know, she's making our lives so easy here. As Professor Necipoğlu mentioned, my project is larger than what I will be presenting today. But first of all, I would like to give a couple of hints about what I'm actually working on. So this is basically what I'm doing, what this project is about. It's about tracing the intertwined histories of three groups of ancient marbles that traveled away from their earlier existence in ruins, crusader castles, and Ottoman collections across valleys and deserts through rivers and oceans to their destination in the British Museum in the 19th century. These are the subtitles of the research. The first three actually about the marbles, the artifacts, the groups of artifacts that I'm working on. But also I'm working on the architectures around these artifacts. The fourth title shows that. And then the texts around these artifacts, the travelogue. This topic gives me the chance to look at those as well. So if the stories that I'm working on actually give me the chance to look beyond the narrow stories of the marbles, but these kinds of things, they give me the chance to study. The first is, to track down the material practices, accompanying narratives, and the heterogeneous responses that they engendered in different cultural contexts, in Europe, in Britain, but also on the Ottoman lands. To shed light on mid-19th century cultural travel collecting and display by highlighting the web of ideas, myths, travelers, diplomats, antiquarians, architectures, and architects surrounding these itinerant objects. So I would like to trace all those huge network of things and actors and objects. But perhaps even more importantly, it gives me the chance to look at the changing attitudes to antiquity on the part of both the British and the Ottomans. Although these artifacts became part of the collections of the British Museum almost within the same decade, they show distinct trajectories. They show different attitudes. And as I said earlier, they also give me the chance to look at the architecture of the British Museum in relation to what I call transcultural collecting, which is very much overlooked in mainstream histories of architecture. And then also, of course, in relation to the travelogue that I had mentioned earlier, I'm studying, looking at these itinerant objects and itinerant Europeans, but also itinerant Ottomans, who too traveled and produced travelogues. The concept of itinerancy is important because transportation of these artifacts was a big deal. It was an arduous task. And the difficulty of it actually kind of played into the idea of heroism that is associated with these big undertakings. On the left, on the left you are seeing the Lycian marbles, the Zantian marbles, being announced at the newspaper, at the Illustrated London News, their arrival to the museum. On the right, you are seeing these The images of Austin Henry Layard's big undertakings about, you know, the transporting the huge, humongous Assyrian material from Mesopotamia to London, sometimes compared with the undertakings done back at the time by the Assyrians themselves. So it was a big deal, of course, to transport those things. Sometimes it would take months, and perhaps even years. And there were also losses that the histories do not really talk that much about. And this is a map in progress. I'm still working on it, but I'm showing you just to give you an idea about the different locales. Eventually, I am hoping to be able to trace the routes that the marbles and people, both the British and the Ottoman, actually followed during this period. As I said, well, I'm an architectural historian, so I'm also very limited on architecture. And I started actually by looking at the British Museum, architecture of the British Museum. And of course, the main take on the British Museum's architecture is there is this plan done by Robert Smirke, which is the ideal pure rectangular figure around the quadrangle. And always, of course, the architectural historians talk about that ideal architectural plan, but in reality, of course, it never worked like that. That pure rectangle was always spoiled, destroyed by the new additions, ad hoc additions that had to be done because of the humongous material, the loads of new material arriving to the museum day by day. So I'm looking at that as well. I'm showing you here the Lycian room. You can see that the museum is made piece by piece, piecemeal, and almost like the rooms are added by themselves. So that is something that I'm also interested in order to look at the construction of the British Museum in the mid 19th century in relation to this transcultural collecting. Before I start with my paper today, these are the gentlemen that I'm interested in. On the left is Charles Fellows, who was more like an adventurer, different than the figure in the middle, Austin Henry Layard, of course, very well known, very famous, the Layard of Nineveh, who has been very much studied recently, and there's a lot of literature about his work of intelligence, let's say. He was also, he was very much, he was. so he's a different figure than Fellows. And on the right, the very well-known, famous, very powerful ambassador, Stratford Canning. According to some British sources, he was even considered like the person who was behind the Tanzimat reforms in the Ottoman Empire. So he was regarded as really this very powerful person. Today I'm going to dwell on one particular group of material, and that is the Canning marbles. That will give me the chance to talk about the Ottoman side of the story a little bit more. Excuse me. Today, today in the West Wing of the British Museum, after crossing the overcrowded Egyptian sculpture gallery and the long and narrow Assyrian galleries, with walls covered with reliefs from Nimrud and Nineveh, one comes to the Hall of Greek and Roman Sculpture, organized around, in museum's own wording, a naked Aphrodite crouching at her bath. Curiously, the vulnerable Aphrodite, arguably a stand-in for the famous Aphrodite of Cnidus, does not only occupy the center of the spacious gallery, but also marks the crossroads of the displays on Assyria, Lycia, and the world of Alexander. Here, at a distance from the Parthenon, or in their 19th century designation, Elgin marbles, flanked by the halls of an oversized Lycian tomb, and that of a caryatid from the Erechtheion, squeezed between the Hellenistic world of Alexander and the back wall of the museum, and on top of architectural fragments, among others, from Ephesus, Athens, and Priene, are two colossal figures, a lion and a horse on iron bars, alongside numerous bas-reliefs from the Amazonomachy frieze, those much sought-after objects of desire for the 19th century European subject, as we will see. These are the remains of the 4th century BCE tomb of King Mausolus from the Hecatomnid dynasty of ancient Caria, which was located in Halicarnassus on the Aegean coast of Turkey, today's Bodrum, and seen as one of the seven wonders of the world in antiquity. Despite its persistence as a legend throughout the centuries and recent excavations, not much is known about the mausoleum. One might argue that the display in room 21, with its shallow ceiling and pale blue walls, does not do justice to its legendary contents, to the probably 50-meter-high massive tomb made up of myriad colossal blocks adorned by a colonnade and the 24-step roof, which was embellished by hundreds of reliefs, gigantic sculptures, and the colossal four-horse chariot on top. Yet for our purposes, what are more interesting are the incongruent narratives produced in different cultural and historical contexts around these fragments, particularly about the Amazonomachy frieze, determinedly brought together by the British over a long stretch of time, not only through excavations on the site of the mausoleum, but also extracted from the walls of the Castle of St. Peter in Bodrum, incorporated there in the 16th century by the Hospitaller Knights of St. John, and from the garden of the 19th century Musée Humayun, the Ottoman Imperial Museum in Istanbul. As a consequence of decades-long effort on the part of the British, the first group of slabs from the Amazonomachy frieze, together with some other pieces, were delivered to the British Museum between September the 15th and the 19th, 1846, by the British ambassador to the Sublime Porte, Stratford Canning, who would later be raised to the peerage as Lord First Viscount de Redcliffe. In contradistinction to the other pieces of the frieze that would be excavated at the mausoleum site in 1857 by Charles Neaton, the famous 19th century keeper of the British Museum, who is credited with the discovery and transportation of not only the remains of the much revered mausoleum of Halicarnassus, but also those of Cnidus and Didyma. The Canning marbles were spolia, incorporated into the 16th century walls of the Hospitaller's castle, a situation which might have enhanced their appeal for European travelers who have petitioned in increasing numbers to visit the castle and produced an intertextual discourse of awe and secrecy around it, particularly after the 17th century, even though by then it had long been in the hands of the Ottomans. The afterlife of the mausoleum of Halicarnassus, particularly the Amazonomachy frieze, which were originally sculpted architectural decorations and immovable elements of a grandiose edifice, prior to becoming cunning marbles in the 19th century, that is prior to having been associated with an individual and named after him as movable possessions, is worth to reiterate. As it will be expounded later, I am interested in the collecting and exhibitionary, as well as architectural practices preceding the emergence of the modern museum and collecting in the 19th century. My aim, however, is not to construct a seamless link between these earlier practices and the modern museum, as is often done in museum literature, but rather to detect the historical and cultural ruptures and discontinuities, as much as the continuities and parallels. Despite its size, the colossal monument apparently disappeared from the site by the Middle Ages, leaving the questions of leaving the questions regarding the exact circumstances, reasons, and the date of its loss unanswered, hence by adding to the puzzles about it. Yet the memory of Halicarnassus and its mausoleum survived in the medieval copies of ancient texts and the lists of the wonders of the world. By then, mausoleum had already been codified as a term denoting a remarkable tomb in classical Latin. Halicarnassus and its mausoleum, while having an afterlife as a trope, had been completely lost as a territory, so much so that after 1407, when the Hospitallers started to build their castle there, they named it Castrum Sancti Petri. It was not known that the area controlled by the Menteşe dynasty was on the site of Halicarnassus until 1494. By that time, the physical location of the prevailing trope had already been established by the Hospitallers, who began to use material from the mausoleum in the construction of their castle in 1494. The repairing and extension of the castle was a continuous and ad hoc process with several phases from 1407 to 1522, for the latter part of which considerable amount of mausoleum material were employed. Not only huge quantities of stone were incorporated into the different structures and walls of the castle, but also lime and mortar were obtained, particularly by burning sculptures. For us, more significantly, during the construction of the Revellino, i.e. the fortified outer... I should have shown this earlier. This is the plan of the British Museum. The marked area is the place where the mausoleum room would be constructed later. It is still, you know, kind of vast open space. Well, this was the one I was looking at. Well, I'm taking from the beginning. For us, more significant, during the construction of the Revellino, i.e. the fortified altar structure on the harbor side of the castle in 1506 and 1507, not only ordinary building blocks, but also some slabs of the Amazon frieze, including the tree on the altar wall, had been used. The Hospitallers seem to have employed well-kept pieces from the mausoleum, not only the slabs from the Amazon frieze, but also several lines and the slab from the central frieze, which they mixed with their own heraldic devices. During this time, the captain of the castle was Costanzo de Apertis, who, as Anthony Luttrell argues, may have been also behind the transport of a slab from the Amazon frieze to Genoa. By the beginning of the 16th century, as is well known, a renewed interest in antiquity had already been started, particularly in Italy. That spirit apparently reached the territories of the Hospitallers as well. Despite not having considered worthy of study for a long time, architectural spoliation, which may cover a whole spectrum of practices, from the reuse and conversion of intact buildings to the reduction of sculptures to lime, has been a common practice in pre-modern times, going back to Roman and late antiquity and extending to different cultures, as we will see, including the Ottomans. In such cultures, vis-a-vis the modern ones, marked by scarcity of construction and artistic material and technology, the reuse of existing material is comprehensible and was pervasive. In its conventional sense, spolia refers to the booty seized from the enemy in a war, the trophies exhibited after a victory. Since the Renaissance, it has also come to be used for the reuse of fragments in a context different than their original one. The 16th century valorization of the spoliated piece per se, accompanied with a quest for its provenance, colored the reception of spolia in subsequent centuries too. As observed by Arnold Esch, conventionally, in the good old antiquarian fashion, attention was bestowed upon the spoliated ancient piece itself, but not upon its inclusion in a new post-antique context. Not surprisingly then, in the mid-19th century, first Stratford Canning and later Charles Newton, in their guess to retrieve the mausoleum pieces from the castle, did not care to record the early modern and by then also Ottoman historical and architectural context, and left conflicting accounts about the exact location of the pieces, leaving the later generations of archaeologists and scholars to puzzle over. In contradistinction to the utilitarian recycling of building material and lime, the use of the slabs from the Amazon frieze and lines, particularly at the Opertis Revellino, clearly had an exhibitionary purpose, which is evidently a consequence of Opertis' classical sensibilities. Yet arguably, Iconographically, too, the combat scenes between Greeks and their exotic enemies displayed on the outer walls of the castle and around gates and the guardhouse reverberate with the situation of the hospitallers who were surrounded by enemy territory beyond the confines of their castle that they fought intermittently. After the Ottomans took Rhodes and the hospitallers left the castle in 1523, European sources seem to be silent about the whereabouts of the mausoleum until Earl of Charlemont's travels in 1749, starting with Richard Dalton, who traveled with the Earl and produced the first recordings of the slabs. There seem to be numerous attempts on the part of the Europeans to visit the Bodrum castle and record the slabs. Along those lines, another British traveler, Charles Fellows, who visited Ottoman Anatolia four times in the 1830s and 1840s and transported extensive remains from Nicaea to the British Museum, writes about, and I quote, the extreme jealousy the Turks have of their fortresses being visited by Franks, end of quotes, quote, and tells the story of some English travelers who had received permission to examine the sculptures built into the walls of the Castle of Bodrum, but not allowed to enter it as the order was for going round the fortification. Alongside with that of French travelers, who made sure that the order specified that they could enter the castle, but could not do so either, as the local governor told them that he could let them in, but had no power to let them out afterwards. Apparently, the stories about the inaccessibility of the Bodrum Castle and the Amazon frieze, coupled with the curious behavior of the Ottomans, abounded and circulated, arguably enhancing the desire for them even more on the part of the British, who by the 19th century had developed an extensive self-identification with ancient cultures and saw the ownership, keepership of such material and natural right, even a universal duty. The recent literature on the history of archaeology, particularly that of the British Museum, on the other hand, despite being more impartial, is still based on some unquestioned assumptions, as in the case of this characterization of early British archaeologists. Ian Jenkins, a curator at the British Museum, who arguably produced the most authoritative work on the history of the sculpture collections of the British Museum, wrote this concerning Charles Newton, and I quote, Newton left for the adventure of a post in the Foreign Service as a vice consul at Mytilene on the island of Lesbos. From many hours spent listing the harvest of their labors, he knew how much the fame of the museum's collections depended upon the efforts of a long and distinguished line of archaeologically minded envoys, men who had exploited the political advantages of the country they represented to endow its national repository of the arts, end of quote. Stratford Canning, too, was an archaeologically minded envoy, like Charles Newton, together with whom he was instrumental in amassing the mausoleum remains in the British Museum. But what does it mean for envoys to be archaeologically minded? Might the coupling of a diplomatic post with antiquarian interests and an urge for transcultural collecting be seen as constituting a natural right? In the existing, that is by and large, European scholarship and literature on early archaeology and museology, conventionally these men are depicted as larger-than-life figures who, in order to endow their national repository of the arts, had to struggle with the Ottomans, whose only objective seemed to make things difficult for Europeans. Consequently, up until very recent times, in such standard accounts, the existence of the Ottomans, from whose lands arguably the majority of ancient material of the 19th century European museums was transferred, is relegated to the absence or presence of what is simplistically called the Sultan's Firman for the removal of antiquities. Quite often, the archive for such literature were antiquarians or adventurers' own writings, a situation further aggravated with the unfamiliarity of the museum curators with Ottoman history, which affirmed the cultural stereotypes about disengaged Ottomans alongside the European claims to the ownership of antiquities. Another charge moment of antagonism between the British and the Ottomans, revolving around yet another group of spolia from the Castle of St. Peter, the lions Charles Newton had noticed on the walls and believed to be from the mausoleum on his visit to Bodrum from Kalymnos in 1855, was perceived by him as such. And I quote, "While we were making these discoveries on the site of the mausoleum, we were anxiously waiting for the firman, empowering me to take possession of the lines, which I had discovered in the castle last year. Unavoidable delays prevented the granting of this document, and in the meantime, the commandant of the castle suddenly received orders from the Turkish Minister of War to remove the lions from the walls and send them to Constantinople. I dispatched two letters to Smyrna to apprise Lord Stratford that the Turkish Minister of War was trying to steal a march on us. Two more lions were soon dug out of the walls. The extraction of two of my eye teeth could not have given me so great a pang," end of quote. But what might be the rationale behind the behavior of the Ottomans? Might there be other motives beyond the humiliation of the British? Thanks to some documents in the Ottoman state archives, now we may come up with some answers and begin to understand the Ottoman agenda as well. From the Ottoman documents, we learned that Stratford Canning petitioned as early as November the 10th, 1843, on Lord Eastner's behalf, for permission to view some ornate ancient stones worth viewing inside the Bodrum Castle. And still more than 2 years later, on January the 5th, 1846, on behalf of Charles Ellison, accompanied by two engineers and a party of four servants for travel permission to Bodrum, who were traveling on duty. The duty, as corroborated by Henry Fawkes Edgell, the commander of Siren the sloop, that carried the Canning marbles from Bodrum to Malta, was the removal of frieze slabs from the castle. What happened in between in those 2 years? On May the 23rd, 1844, an appeal was made by the British for the extraction of five stones depicting animal forms, as we learn from a letter sent to the governor of Aydın from the Sublime Porte, inquiring about the exact place, number, and weight of the stones in a concerned tone, pointing to the probable harm the extraction might cause, as the said stones, and I quote, were not on the ground or a part of anybody's land or home, but in the walls of the castle, end of quote. And after the correspondence with the local administrators on September 21st and 22nd, 1844, the Supreme Council of Judicial Ordinances, Meclis-i Vala, seems to have discussed the situation and arrived at the conclusion that the extraction of the stones could not be done without any harm to the castle. The decision of the Supreme Council, however, did not seem to have deterred Canning from making new appeals. From another lengthy irade, accompanied with a sketch and description of 11 such stones, December 31st, 1845, we learned that Canning was offended yet insistent, while the council, which was upset about the persistent request and the increased number of stones that were asked for, sent an engineer to report on the situation and reluctantly agreed to the extraction of only two if the British could not be convinced otherwise. They also added, and I quote, "As the placing and collecting of such antique stones that are seen at some parts of this revered country by the organization of a place called museum, will require some beneficial deeds and will be taken care of in the future, when it will be natural to refute such pleas. Now it has become clear that opposing the donation would offend Mr. Canning." Mr. Canning'in kırılacağı in Turkish. End of quote. According to the current archival evidence, this seems to be the first mention of the establishment of a museum of antiquities on Ottoman territory. One way of avoiding such requests, the council thought, was to found a museum. The decree literally said, a place called museum, where such antique stones would be placed and collected. As is well known, the date of 1845-1846 coincides with the date the literature on the history of Ottoman museology conventionally gives without much evidence as that of a modest collection of antiquities, magazine of antiquities, in Istanbul, that was put together alongside a collection of antique arms and armors, magazine of ancient weapons, in the former church of Hagia Irine on the grounds of the Topkapı Palace, the Ottoman imperial palace that had been built by Mehmet II on the ancient Acropolis of Constantinople after the Ottoman conquest of Istanbul in the 15th century. The dual collections of antiquities and weapons, together with a sartorial exhibit, which would prove to be quite lasting, about the recently abolished military corps, Janissaries, were organized within the 6th century Byzantine church of Ayerine, which had been converted into a cebehane, a storehouse not only of arms and ammunition, but also of war spolia, including arms, armors, and Byzantine relics in the 15th century. Before dwelling on the triple collections, a look at the pre-19th century exhibitionary and collecting practices may be worthwhile. Having become part of the first and the most public courtyard of the imperial palace after the construction of the outer walls surrounding it, the meaning of the former Byzantine church, despite changes over time, ultimately seems to go beyond that of a utilitarian storage. Not only what it contains inside as some kind of imperial vault, the relics, weapons, and armors, among others, but the monumental edifice, the second largest church of Constantinople itself, too, was war spolia, a reminder of the victory and superiority of the Ottomans over the Byzantines. In contradistinction to the hospitallers of St. John, who despoiled the tomb of Mausolus in Halicarnassus for construction and decorative material, and a couple of decades earlier than them, the Ottomans adapted an intact edifice for both utilitarian and arguably symbolic purposes, building on its former significance. Interestingly, although the access to the interior was strictly controlled, the building acted as a background, a stage for some Ottoman rituals of superiority and power. The first courtyard of the palace with cebehane and some other unassuming service buildings added and transformed in time, such as Ambar-ı Amire and Darphane, although not completely accessible to all, was the most public of the palace courtyards. Where ceremonies took place, the visitors could enter on horseback, and the foreign ambassadors waited their reception by the Sultan with their entourage. The exhibitionary rituals enacted with cebehane, a war booty, and the storage for the inaccessible and potentially frightening Ottoman military assets as their backdrop included the display of wild and exotic animals brought from the nearby menagerie and chained in the front during the visits of foreign ambassadorial groups, and the display of Sultan's horsetail standards in front of Cebehane's gate sometime before the Sultan leaves Istanbul for a war campaign. Later, starting in the 17th century, the ancient arms and armors, first early Ottomans, and in the 19th century, increasingly the despoiled Byzantine and Christian ones, were started to be displayed and paraded on horses on holidays. The choice of Ayerine for such displays cannot be accidental. Its existence must have augmented the intended image of the powerful victorious Ottomans for friend and foe. Arguably, from the very beginning, cebehane, the former Byzantine church, had a somewhat covert exhibitionary role as well, perhaps not very different than the display of the Amazon frieze slabs on the walls of the castle of St. Peter by hospitallers for antiquarian purposes, but possibly also as a deterring sign for adversaries. Then it is not surprising that the choice of place turned out to be Ayerine, İç Cebehane, or Enderun Cebehanesi, as it has come to be alternately called, when an exhibition of ancient arms, armors, and relics were put together around 1726, during the reign of Ahmed III. In other words, the covert exhibitionary task of the former church turned military storehouse was taken from the outside to the inside through the repair and reorganization of the edifice, which was renamed Darul Esliha, the House of Arms. Recently, it has been persuasively argued that the earlier 18th century interventions in cebehane might have included the addition of most probably a wooden revac entrance portico to the northern entrance, the organization of the vestibule, and the entrance corridor with newly built vaulted rooms, and most importantly, a throne room for the Sultan, a Taht-ı Hümayun Mahalli, arguably at the same place with the one seen today, flanking the narthex wall looking down to the atrium. While apparently the House of Arms could be visited by a select group of Ottoman and foreign visitors, the principal audience, at least symbolically, was the Sultan himself, for whom a special locale was created. The 1726 inscription above the main entrance not only boasts the extensive repairs that rendered the edifice similar to a newly built one, glorifies Ahmed III with numerous praises, but also belittles the legendary heroes of the Safavids, with whom the Ottomans were at war at that particular moment. It also mentions some war machines that the Sultan, I quote, secured with his sword, which were hidden behind the walls for protection against the enemies, end of quote, which might be the war booty that were recently put in Cebehane. The repair and renovation of Darul Esliha was done in the context of extensive architectural and urban transformations that followed the return of the Ottoman court to Istanbul in 1703, after several decades spent in Edirne. Defeat by and peace with Europeans and war with the Safavids constitute the political context of Darul Esliha, which is, without much evidence of a historical connection, often compared to cabinets of curiosities, those unsystematic collections of natural and artificial objects of curiosity put together by antiquarians, scholars, and princes in early modern Europe. But for a possible model for such a collecting and exhibitionary practice before Europe, we need to turn our gaze to the Ottoman imperial palace itself. As Gülü Necipoğlu has shown us, beginning with Mehmet II, the inner treasury in the third courtyard of Topkapı Palace, with its underground vaults and, most importantly, multi-tiered niches designed for displaying objects as much as storing them, was comparable to a schatzkammer for precious and exotic artifacts, in addition to being a storage space for archival documents, household furnishings, and clothing, among many others. Although it is known that Mehmet II's unorthodox interests in scholarly pursuits, collecting, and Greco-Roman heritage had not been pursued by later sultans, according to a 1496 inventory compiled for Bayezid II, among the myriad things that had been amassed in the treasury were ropes, kaftan, swords, chessboards, elephant's tusks, rhinoceros horns, shark's teeth, and Qurans, alongside objects of silver and gold, books and illustrations, turbans, brocades, astrolopes, and astronomical instruments. Despite frequent losses, the inner treasury throughout the centuries remained flooded with objects because of the continuous arrival of gifts, confiscated properties, and booty. As late as 1885, a visitor to the palace, a reporter from the Times, wrote, and I quote, "The Great Museum of Constantinople is, of course, the Sultan's treasury in the Serario." This was after the Musée Humayun was really flourished. Necipoğlu recounts the extensive preparations done to decorate the treasury with the artifacts drawn from its numerous coffers, chests, caskets, cupboards, and cellars, some of which, namely the swords belonging to the prophet, caliphs, and other holy men, were hung on colorful textiles suspended from the dome for Bayram ceremonies in 1613. Furthermore, weapons, shields, armor, gilded and jeweled horse tacks were used to decorate the walls of a hall up to the ceiling, described as seferhanesi, the military campaign compartment. Ahmed I apparently visited this exhibit several times, each artifact on display providing him the chance to contemplate and drive a specific lesson, and making him thankful to God for all the treasures. A century later, the interventions in Cebehane, organizing it as Darul Esliha, complete with a throne room for the Sultan, Taht-ı Humayun Mahalle, done following a victory and after war booty was placed there, can arguably be seen as replicating the exhibitionary practices that had long been enacted in the inner treasury. The first antiquities collection at the Ottoman court, Mecmai Asar Atika, too was put together inside this former exhibitionary space that functioned as cebehane for amassing all sorts of material from war spolia, as we have seen, arms, and horror relics, to later also valuable construction materials were added to that for centuries, and which was started to be called Harbiye Ambarı in 1839, military storehouse. If we go back to our earlier argument about Stratford Canning's petitions for the removal of mausoleum spolia from the walls of the Bodrum Castle, now we know that the first official discussion in December 1845 about setting up an Ottoman Museum of Antiquities was actually triggered by Stratford Canning's insistence and the transfer of the Canning marbles to the British Museum. Interestingly, Abdülmecid, the Ottoman Sultan, who as stated in the British Museum's website, became the donor of the Canning marbles almost a year ago on February 4, 1845, in a similar situation reacted differently and intervened in the purchase of an underpriced antiquity by the Danish Consul on the island of Cyprus and ordered that such antique stones should be accumulated in Cebehane-i Amire and ancient silver and gold in Darphane. By February the 15th, 1846, only a short time after the first discussion of the Supreme Council about founding a museum for antiquities in Istanbul, a new organization had already been made within Cebehane, or Harbi Ambarı, former Darul Esliha, to that effect, with the initiative of the Grand Master of the Artillery, Damat Rodosizade Fethi Ahmet Paşa. Although in the correspondence concerning the reorganization, there is a reference to the European states where places called museums were allocated and organized for antiquities with great effort, and the employment of foreign officials for the study of the arriving antiquities, hence an attempt to emulate a European practice is apparent. We also learned that there were already chant some antiquities in Harbi Ambarı. As in the case of Darul Esliha, the ongoing practice of collecting was once again rendered visible through the reorganization of the already existing material for exhibitionary purposes. Another document dated November the 16th, 1846, on the other hand, mentions the already established museum for antiquities depicting human and animal forms in Harbi Ambarı, where such material were now being amassed in the plans by the Grand Master of the Artillery to make a separate arrangement for ancient weapons and other objects, which were claimed to be scattered throughout the building and in a state of disarray. By demolishing, and I quote, by demolishing and rebuilding the round arched edifice in front of the existing museum, end of quote. The organization of the antiquities collection had been done prior to that of the ancient arms and armors, i.e. the contents of the aforementioned 18th century Darul Esliha, which had already become obsolete by the mid-19th century. Yet eventually, the two sides of the atrium colonnade had been allocated respectively to antiquities and to ancient weapons and marked as such by the inscriptions above the portals leading to each collection. The latter, however, would spread beyond the atrium colonnade, Art historian Wendy Shaw, in her study of the Ottoman museology and archaeology, wrote, and I quote, "The spaces of the magazine of antique weapons carefully frame specific episodes in Ottoman history to their best advantage, while marking the passage of archaic institutions in a glorious but distanced history. The artillery collections were located in the vestibule, the main body of the church, and the apse. Mannequins depicting the Janissaries graced the gallery, and the atrium served as a transitional space between the antiquities of war and the antiquities of culture, located in the magazine of antiquities." The importance given to the reorganization of Harbi Ambarı, Cebehane, as an exhibitionary space is also apparent in the reconstruction of a room for the Sultan, now called Hücre-i Padişah, literally Sultan's room, and probably at the same place with the 18th century Taht-ı Hümayun, in the atrium colonnade, flanking the narthex in a subdued French decorative language, which can still be partly seen. The opening of the Mecmua-i Asar-ı Atika, defined as an archaeological museum, and the official campaign for collecting and dispatching antiquities to Istanbul have been announced in European and Levantine newspapers such as Journal de Constantinople, Morning Post, Lincolnshire Chronicle, and Reading Mercury. We are not well informed about the display criteria operative at the early years of Mecmua-i Asar-ı Atika. Based on visitor accounts and Albert Dumont's 1868 catalog, prepared 2 decades after the inception of the collection and a decade after Fethi Ahmet Pasha's death, that emphasized the lack of proper labels, taxonomic criteria, and the mixing of antiquities with other objects, such as weapons and Janissary mannequins, Shaw argues that in contradistinction to the contemporary Western engagement with the classical past that was based on evolutionary narratives and classification, the Ottomans was a modernizing gesture aimed to show their participation in the contemporary European practice through the possession of antiquities dispatched to the capital from their territories. While the founding documents we have seen, which do not elaborate further than the terms vase and gem, to place and to collect, that would reveal any display criterion, can be seen as supportive of Shaw's claim, the plan to hire foreign employees might be related to a wish to engage with European expertise in classical antiquity. The collections, as described by those few contemporary sources, appear to have combined an effort to glorify the Ottoman imperial past, as in the case of Darul Esliha, or the preceding century, with the contemporary practice of antiquity collecting. Accordingly, as the material in the Ottoman archives shows, and as mentioned in contemporary newspapers, starting in the 1840s, there were increasing correspondence sent from the provinces about the discovery and dispatch of antiquities to Istanbul. By then, some members of the Ottoman elite, too, already held private collections. Charles Fellows, for instance, during his second visit to Anatolia, stopped in Aydın in as early as March 1840, and writes about the much-visited museum of Tahir Pasha, who discovered statues and preserved them in his mansion, and that Fellows finds to be of a base Roman age. Fellows writes, and I quote, "How strange it seems that such specimens as the following should alone be prized, when the country is rich in the works of the ancient Greeks. Upon two marble blocks, apparently pedestals, which are now built into the wall on either side of the entrance to the Pasha's house, are bas-reliefs of a low age, probably Byzantine, or perhaps as late as the Crusades. They each have a superscription. On the other side of the door is a somewhat similar pedestal with this inscription. These were found only a few months ago, as well as several broken statues, which are preserved with great care by the Pasha, who is anxious to acquire the European taste for such things at present, a well-sculptured eagle, which has lost its own head, is supplied with that of a female figure." End of quote. She wasn't impressed. Rather than waiting for antiquities dispatched from the provinces, the Sublime Porte, as early as 1847, took a proactive stand and sent officials to excavate in Turhala, Thessaly. After the discovery of some carved marbles there, who, together with the governor of Turhala, oversaw the digging of pieces, including a Greek sarcophagus and some jewelry. The small pieces apparently were put in a bag and sent to Istanbul in April 1847. Accordingly, when Charles Newton had arrived in Lesbos in 1852 as vice consul, and later on October the 20th, 1853, applied with the help of Stratford Canning for permission to excavate antiquities on the island of Kalymnos to none other than Fethi Ahmed Pasha, and for Bodrum, there was already a mounting effort on the parts of the Ottomans to regulate the procedures regarding antiquities. On November the 11th, 1856, while his permission was extended a year, Newton was told to submit a copy to Sultanate Seniye Müzesi in the case of finding duplicate or multiple copies of the same object. Now we may return to the lions decorating the walls of the Bodrum Castle that Newton thought the Turkish Minister of War was trying to seize from them. Indeed, Damat Rodosizade Fethi Ahmed Pasha, who became the Grand Master of the Artillery, first in January 1845 until 1852, and on and off between 1853 and 1854, and finally between 1857 and 1858, on February the 2nd, 1857, just after resuming the position for the last time, petitioned about the removal of an antique lion's head from the Castle of Bodrum that was worthy of keeping in a museum. Among the correspondence regarding the lions, there is also a report describing the condition of four lions, work of ancient Greeks, Rumların, and claiming that their replacement wouldn't be harmful and would even strengthen the walls of the castle, which should be supervised by a public official and for which the permission should be swiftly granted. Robert Murdoch Smith, however, who was participating in Newton's explorations of the mausoleum site wrote, and I quote, "It would appear from the accounts brought to us that when the firman was asked for by Lord Stratford, the request was granted by the port, and as the lions were in the walls of the fortress, the firman was placed in the hands of Fethi Pasha, the war minister." End of quote. According to the current evidence, on the other hand, not before but after Fethi Ahmed Pasha's petition, an official letter by Abdul Majid was sent to the Pasha concerning the presentation of a lion's head that was found in the Castle of Bodrum to the Museum of the Grand English State, İngiltere Devleti Fehimesi Müzesi, on February the 27th, 1857, which gave the British the authority to submit in Newton's word, the most inferior of the four lions, actually a lioness, to the commandant of the castle, who had them extracted from the walls by the order of Fethi Ahmed Pasha in order to be sent to Istanbul. But who was this Fethi Ahmed Pasha? This is the plan and the section of the Hücre-i Padişah. But who was this Fethi Ahmed Pasha? Newton and Murdoch Smith insistently describe as the Minister of War. He was the Grand Master of the Artillery, a military post which was also responsible from the Harbi Yambarı, former Aya İrini Cebehane Darül Esliha, where he would organize the triple collection of antiquities, antique weapons, and Janissary costumes in 1846, as we have already seen. The date of the first mention of an Ottoman museum in the Supreme Council, triggered by the Canning Marbles in December 1845, coincides with his appointment as the Grand Master of the Artillery in January 1845. Fethi Ahmed Pasha, who had already proved himself a good soldier and statesman during Mahmud II's reign, was particularly close to Mahmud's successor, Abdülmecid, as evinced by the bestowal upon him the damat, son-in-law status. Pasha was chosen by the Sultan himself, who was enthroned at the very young age of 16 and was more than 20 years younger than Fethi Ahmed Pasha, as the spouse for his sister Atiye in 1839, at the very beginning of his reign. Pasha and Atiye Sumtu's wedding would be the first royal wedding of the Tanzimat era. Ottoman historian Cevdet Pasha writes, and I quote, "His Royal Highness Abdülmecid Han saw Fethi Pasha as a personal advisor, a confidant, even about the matters of the imperial court, and the guardian, Hami, to himself." End of quote. Not surprisingly then, Abdülmecid consulted Fethi Ahmed Pasha when Austin Henry Layard applied for permission to further excavate in Mosul and export his finds in 1850. Fethi Ahmed Pasha's answer was, and I quote, "Randomly chosen people have been exporting antiquities, which have a position like a spiritual key to human history, and this situation is inappropriate and does not fit the glorious Ottoman Empire. Therefore, it must be forbidden completely. The preparation of regulations designed to secure such antiquities for the Imperial Museum is already in hand." End of quote. Furthermore, the same year, Fethi Ahmed Pasha came up with a set of rules and procedures akin to regulations such as duplicates of any finds should be surrendered to the Ottoman government, unique finds were to be retained by the excavator, permission should be obtained from the owners of any private lands to be excavated, and governmental permission for all excavations would be valid for 1 year. As we have seen, the same conditions were demanded from Newton upon his request to extend his permission to excavate in Bodrum. During the whole period, from Stratford Canning's initial attempt about the Amazon freeze in 1845 to that of Newton about the lions of the castle in 1857, Fethi Ahmed Pasha was trying to put together a museum of Asar Atika in Istanbul and develop regulations regarding excavations and archaeology in Ottoman lands, an attempt that might have had some hiatus because of Fethi Ahmed Pasha's frequent appointment and removal from the post of the Grand Marshal of the Artillery. Interestingly, Fethi Ahmed Pasha's family, known as having contributed to the conquest of the island from the Hospitaller Knights of St. John in the 16th century, was from Rhodes too. In the 19th century, Pasha still maintained ties with the island and had a school and a clock tower built there through his foundation. Although originally a military man, he also served as an ambassador to Vienna, Paris, and Moscow, where he seems to have been a part of the elite society, leading a cosmopolitan life. Apparently, Fethi Ahmed Pasha knew how to dance, gave balls, and composers such as Johann Strauss wrote music for him. In Istanbul as well, he led a sumptuous life as his lavish yalı, one of the most expensive ones on the Bosphorus, by the way, even now, his lavish yalı at Kuzguncuk demonstrates. Before becoming the Grand Master of the Artillery in 1837, he briefly served as the governor of Aydın, a post responsible for arbitrations related to the many ancient sites and remains in its vicinity. As already mentioned, the 1840s were a period of reforms for the Ottomans, starting with the declaration of the Tanzimat Ferman in 1839 by the newly enthroned young Abdülmecid. Within that atmosphere of modernizing reforms, even though it's not possible to talk about a widespread recognition and appropriation of antiquity on the part of the Ottomans along the lines of the British, who had developed an extensive self-identification with and self-righteousness about the keepership of ancient cultures, it's possible to trace a determined attempt by Fethi Ahmed Pasha to start an imperial collection and develop rules and regulations about antiquities. Although the forms the Ottoman perception and appropriation of antiquity took in different times and contexts, which were arguably different than those of the British, are beyond the scope of this study, I would take issue with the arguments that see the development of archaeology in different European contexts as the only yardstick to evaluate the Ottoman attitudes. On the other hand, as we have seen, the Ottoman court in Istanbul had some collecting and exhibition practices all along. Fethi Ahmed Pasha's early Tanzimat attempts to form an imperial collection of antiquities at the palace seems to have been built on such practices as much as the contemporary modern or European interest in antiquity. Despite the efforts of Fethi Ahmed Pasha, why could the Imperial Museum not flourish earlier than it actually did? There were sporadic attempts, such as the 1869 regulations, in addition to those of the 1874 and 1884, the appointment of new museum directors in 1869 and 1872, the catalogs of 1868 and 1871, the move to the new location of the tiled pavilion in 1880. Yet Musée Humayun was even, this is later named as the Musée Humayun, was even closed for a period at the beginning of the 1870s. It's interesting that some documents concerning the 1869 regulations that seems to have been triggered by John Turtlewood's transport of material from Ephesus to the British Museum and would completely ban the transfer of antiquities outside Ottoman territory emphasizes the necessity of a perfect imperial museum without mentioning Mecmua-i Asar Atika. We know that in 1857, the governor of the island of Samos offered the government to excavate in the ancient cities of Ephesus and Miletus in order to enrich the Ottoman Museum and render it one of the most famous ones in Europe in return of 100,000 kursh, which Fethi Ahmed Pasha found reasonable, and Abdülmecid gave his consent by emphasizing the importance of antiquities for the science of history. This was on March the 19th, 1857. Yet after this, until the alarming 1869 plea for a perfect museum, not much activity seems to have occurred regarding Fethi Ahmed Pasha's Mecmua-i Asar-ı Atika. Consequently, Osman Hamdi Bey, who became the director much later in 1881, and who is seen as instrumental in transforming it into a museum compatible with modern international standards, is generally regarded as the founder of the Ottoman museology and archaeology, as is very well known. Yet, one cannot help but speculate. Is it only a coincidence that Fethi Ahmed Pasha actually died in 1858 after the incident about the lions from the Bodrum Castle? If he had lived longer, would archaeology and museology in Ottoman lands have been on a different track? Would that have changed the fate of the other piece of Amazon frieze that Newton had seen in the garden of the Mecmua-i Asar-ı Atika in 1852, which was part of the collection that Fethi Ahmed Pasha arranged? And the British persistently demanded, even after decades in 1879, by claiming that none of them would be good by itself, since the other part of the stone was already in the British Museum. The Ottoman side of the story regarding antiquities in the Ottoman lands, as already mentioned, was not well known up until very recently. Now we know that they were not that oblivious to the British explorations in Ottoman lands, and the reason for their behavior was not only to fight and humiliate the British. The Ottomans actually had an imperial agenda as early as the 1840s. With the permission of Abdülhamid II, the last piece of the Amazon frieze was sent to the British Museum and joined the others in 1879. This was 2 years before the appointment of Osman Hamdi Bey as the director of the Musée Humayun in 1881, who would pick it up where Fethi Ahmed Pasha had left off and launch a fierce campaign for developing the Ottoman Imperial Museum. Thank you.